This
recording
is...
in progress.
Okay. This is regular meeting of the Board of Finance, August 13th, 2024, being held in the Selectman's Conference Room. This is a hybrid meeting. We have, I'm going to call for a quorum, and we don't have a phone. Okay. It will. We're not going, I'm sure, to do that. All right, so members of the board who are here, Martha Azzarisi, Katie Heiser, Katie what did I just?
Katie Heiser. Sally Anderson.
Flash in the past, Sally Heiser, I'm sorry. John Rabelsi and Katie Erickson online on the Zoom. Okay. Let's see. The first item on our agenda, this is something we have not done before, is a public comment. I was asked to put this on. Normally, when we speak to the public, it's when an item, specific item, is in front of us. So for anyone who wants to be recognized and wants to speak to us, please limit yourselves to 3 minutes, but understand that we're doing this now instead of having conversations with people when the item comes up in front of us, which is has been our normal practice. Okay, so we'll see how this goes. Who would like to go first? Is there anyone online? Any of you want to go first?
I'm happy to go first.
All right.
I'm on the list. Should I speak from?
Yeah, you don't have to speak from that.
But right here is okay.
That's fine.
Great. I will start by saying I'm a little prepared to speak.
Tell us your name.
Oh, sorry. Erin Gorski, 19 Mitchell Road. And I want to first thank the Board of Finance for all of the work that you do, which I know is vast. And also for being a resource that does seem to really listen to the town. As you all know, our town is in crisis right now. I am here speaking for other people that I've spoken to around the issue with Park and Rec. I know that Board of Finance does not have an ability to unilaterally make decisions or anything like that, but I would just implore you to consider doing everything you can in your power to encourage shutting down Park and Rec and having a reset. I know that Bethany Community School is offering some options. I know that those options aren't necessarily economical for everyone in the town, but if we shut down Park and Rec, then all of those people can be terminated without worrying about legal issues because there's no longer someplace for them to work for. Perhaps there's clarity there that the lawyer has on that. And also the salaries that are coming in could be used to help hopefully offset the costs for families. You know, with the inaction that is happening at the top, if there's anything that you can do to encourage some action, I think I and many of the people in the town appreciate it. And I don't think everyone in Park and Rec is horrible. I think there's lovely people who work for Park and Rec, but the problem is that there's so much unknown and so much that is not being told to us. So without knowing that, I really think we need to have a reset and then, you know, it's an opportunity for the town to do what's right for the residents and work together with the community school, with the town officials to build something that is something that Bethany is proud of. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I piggyback off of her comments, please?
Excuse me?
Can I piggyback off of her comments? Name and address.
Sure, just name and address.
I'm 30 more comments. All right. I think the easiest way to work right now is just like, the condemned building. You can always fix the condemned building. You have to blow it up, knock it down to the core, and rebuild from the ground up. And I think the majority of our community would believe that that is the best option at this point.
Okay. Anyone online?
I was just going to say, I don't see anything.
Anyone online who would like to speak as part of the public comment? Okay, then we will go on with the regular agenda. So we have minutes of 4 different meetings. We've had issues with having a quorum of people available. For the April 4th minutes, we had Huxley, Azarisi, Heiser, and Erickson present. We are all present today. Would someone like to make a motion concerning the April 4th 2024 minutes?
I'm going to accept.
Okay, do I have a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Questions, comments? Katie, do you have any comments? You're on mute, by the way.
Thank you.
Excuse me. I'm sorry, Katie. We cannot hear a word that you're saying. You're breaking up. Can you try that one more time? Okay. Katie,
she can put it in the chat if she wants to.
Katie, if you can hear me, if you would you text someone? Someone who, or you could call. Well, I think she probably is on her phone. So
just lost her. She may be trying again.
And let us know whether you are willing to approve these or should we table them. Let's just start there.
She's not anymore.
She's
not. So we have someone coming in, so we still have a quorum.
We still have a quorum, but not on these minutes.
But not a quorum of those present.
Yeah, okay. So we will move to those. And that was the budget hearing. And we have to table it. Until if she comes back on, we can. Okay, so we have the minutes of June 11th, 2024, Huxley, Azarisi, Heiser, Erickson, and Demanda. Okay. What, she's back?
No, but we need Katie for that one as well.
We need Katie or Lars. Okay. And next, June 17th, Huxley, Demanda, Erickson, Heiser, Azarisi. Okay, 1, 2, 3, absent John Gabeski. We do 1, 2, 3. We do not have.
Hold on. What? Katie, are you there?
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. Hold on. Okay, I have Katie on the phone.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. We're going to move you to the center. We're going to move you to the center of the room, Katie.
Thank you for the accommodation.
You're welcome.
All right. Do you have reasonable phone service?
No.
Okay. All right. So we need you on all of these minutes.
Okay, I reviewed them all.
All right. So the April 4th one, we have a motion to approve. Do you have any comments or?
April 4th. I no comment. I will approve.
Okay. So those in favor? Sally?
Sally in favor?
Okay. Thank you. Sally just left the room. All right. Now.
Wait, hang on a second. I'm just making sure. June 11th. Yeah, I approve. June 11th. I have.
Okay. We don't have a motion on that. Could I have a motion on the June 11th?
I'll make a motion.
Okay. All right, and Katie's okay with it. I am okay with it. They're all in favor. Okay. And then we have what, June 17th. Oh, wait a minute. Oh,
wait, June 11th.
Yeah,
we just voted.
I have comments on June 11th.
Oh, you have comments on June 11th?
Oh,
okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you said no comments. All right. Would you like to share your comments and we'll revisit our vote?
Yes. Thank you. I need some suggestion on how to incorporate my comments, and so, but my, it's regarding section 4A, the grant.
Yes.
The language there is where Donna's requesting, you know, money for ARPA funding, and it's because we, for the electrical panels, mm-hmm. and it's because that the request to pay for the, I think it was the generators was paid out of the capital reserve. And the language does state that it was noted that the check was already cut and funds cannot be moved out of the capital reserve. But it was, I feel like it doesn't express my frustration and disappointment with being put in that position to have to approve something that the town meeting, it should have been approved at the town meeting because it was, in general, like, adding to an already approved ARPA request. Do you know what I mean?
I do, but it was a separate request of 10,000.
Right, but it was to an addition to the project for the generators. Do you know what I mean?
I do, yeah. I understand. Yeah, I do understand what you're saying. I think that's not something that we had as part of our set of criteria for how we handle things up until now, but it might definitely be an issue later tonight.
Nonetheless, I feel like meetings don't capture the spirit of exactly what happened, and that like the board was sort of forced into approving it. You know what I mean?
Question from Ben.
Yeah, I was at that meeting, and is it fair? I think you may have actually expressed outwardly frustration in the way that it was handled. And so, what if the minutes were to be amended to reflect that you expressed frustration in the manner in which this proceeded?
Yeah, that is what I'm looking for.
Right? So this way, it would capture your frustration.
Okay. I think that's a reasonable request.
I think it's totally reasonable.
That's what I heard her say.
Thank you. Jeff, did you get that? Mm-hmm. Okay. So with that amendment to the minutes, do we have approval? Do I have a motion to amend the minutes?
I move to amend the minutes.
Okay, I'll second that. Discussion? All in favor?
She said. So there were several of us that were.
Okay.
So kind of upset with that.
You're approving the amendment, and then you have to approve the amendment.
Did you vote?
No, that's fine.
Okay. All right. So the change will be made in the minutes. Now, do we have an approval for the amended minutes? All right. Motion. Another motion. Okay. Martha.
Mm-hmm.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, we have a second and Sally. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so done. Oh, you want? That's right. You want that. All right, then the receptions. No.
That's one is June 17th.
June 17th. Okay. So this one, we have a Tending were Huxley, Demander, Erickson, and Heiser. So we have four of us. One, two, three, four. Yep, we have four of us. And do I have a motion?
I'll move that to there.
Okay. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Comments? Anybody?
I have a clarification. It's a small one, but
okay.
I think it would read better. I don't even know what page it is.
Okay.
I guess the second page on the top. It says in that first paragraph in the top, the second, the last sentence of that, it says the letter clearly states it will not approve our solid waste contract without being compliant.
Mm-hmm.
I would like it to be clarified to state D.
All right, so you want to insert the letters DEEP between the and letter?
No, state.
That works too. Replace it with D. Either one is fine.
The letter clearly states.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Will not approve the solid waste.
Gotcha. All right. Now, these minutes have been approved in this by the Board of Selectmen. But they made some amendments also. I think that this, I agree with this amendment.
I can make a notation just to mention it, Kevin, next Board of Selectmen, that that correction was made.
Thank you. I think that that clarification is definitely appropriate. So was that a motion to amend the minute? To add the E, yeah.
Okay, I have a comment. I don't know if we want to clarify on the last.
Okay, can we vote? Okay, this amendment first.
Okay. I didn't know if we wanted to further amend them.
We will. Okay, we can, but this is one.
Okay.
One amendment, right? Anything else on this one with the D comment? All right, those in favor of that amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, now where?
The last vote on the last page of those minutes, when they're talking about the Board of Finance vote, the Board of Selectmen meeting, Gina had made a mention that it would be nice if the motion was spelled out. It does say that Martha voted no, but it does not state who voted yes and who abstained. And I didn't know if you wanted to clarify that for the record, how you actually voted.
I thank you for saying that. I actually did highlight that for correction as well, to clarify who was the abstention.
Okay. So, all right, who amended? Who?
Sharon, I believe we did abstain from that.
Yes, oh, Sharon okay. Did abstain.
All right. Okay, yes, that's, looks like, okay. And is there a...
So it would have been Heiser, Demander, and Erickson that voted yes.
Voted yes. Martha voted no, and I abstained. I would like to further modify that paragraph, because it says Finance Board Member Katie Erickson motioned. No. Motion is an activity. Moved. I would like to change that word to moved.
Moved to amend.
You can make a motion, or you can move. I know I'm picky. That's another friendly amendment. Can we agree to that change in the paragraph, both of those changes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So, all in favor? Okay. Now we revisit the minutes of the meeting as amended in two places. We have a motion. We have made the changes. Those in favor of approving the minutes? Katie?
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
All right, so that's everyone voting in favor. July 15th, we have Huxley, Azarese, Heiser, and Demander, and Grabowski. So we have a quorum on from that one also. Do I have a motion? Okay, moved by Sally Heiser. Do I have a second?
John.
Okay, thank you. All right, so this was the, at the request of the Board of Selectmen to go to the town meeting with a with a request for a retainer for independent counsel. Obviously, this got changed at the town meeting. Nevertheless, this is to represent what we did at our meeting. Does anyone have any changes they'd like to see?
Yeah.
Lars has listed twice in both votes.
Lars.
Demander.
Where?
It should be Demander and Grabowski.
Okay, so. Yeah, sounds like it anyway, doesn't it? All right, so can I have a motion to amend? Somebody? Okay, thank you, Sally. Second, and John seconded. Those in favor of the amendment, which takes the two, Demander. Okay. All right, those in favor? All right, so now we have the amended minutes. We have a motion and a second, and the amendment has been approved. Those in favor of the amended motion? Okay. Katie?
I'm gonna say.
Katie. Oh, that's right, Katie wasn't there. Okay. Thank you. Those are approved. Wow, we struck 5 minutes, haven't we? Off the agenda. It's been a while since we managed to do that. Okay, the finance director's report. Leslie.
I only included 24 numbers because we are 1 month into 25. So, and I've been focusing on trying to close fiscal year 24, which is why those are the numbers that you have. You have departmental overall numbers and an ARPA review. Is there any particular area of any of the reports that you would like me to discuss in detail? No, I'm just talking about the numbers.
Oh, you just mean the.
I'm just referring to the numbers right now. Was there anything that jumped out at anyone that you wanted an explanation on?
There's a couple that came up to me, areas that were actually under budget, not complaining, but just wanting to talk through why. For example, I'm noticing in the finance department,
mm-hmm.
and in the assessors, and I'm wondering if that has to do with salaries. It seems like unfilled positions, vacancies might be driving those.
In the finance office, yes, that was part of it. There is one purchase, there is one encumbrance in the finance department that is not reflected on the report, but it is reflected on the first report by the department, but it is reflected on the comprehensive report with the income and expenses. Yes, I had a vacancy for probably 6 months. So that helped bring that down. And the person that I brought in came in at a different rate. In the assessor's office, part of it was because of lack of a second person. And another part on that was because the online access, that fee that we are charged every year by QDS, was not charged last year because of the reval. It was built into the cost of the reval. So there is a transfer to move some of that money. So that's why those two departments were under budget. Anything else, Katie?
Well, you touched on my other question, which was I reviewed this on my computer, but I didn't print it out. So I was generally wondering the difference between this report and the one that came after, which you said maybe was a comprehensive report.
Well, the first one just is the departmental breakdown, because when I pulled the income and expense report as a combination report, it doesn't sum up the total dollars spent by department. It just gives you the individual lines and how much was spent, which is why I do the departmental report as well, so that you can see if the department was over or under, as opposed to just an expense line.
Okay.
Because historically, we have been told by our previous auditors that as long as the department is in balance, it's okay if the individual lines within the department go over. But make sure that the department stays in budget. So that we're not, it's more transparent that way, where we know how to correct our budgeting going, you know, for the next year, if we see where we run over versus what we budgeted. Is there anything on the income that anyone had questions on?
One other thing is on the legal.
Okay.
County council.
Mm-hmm.
We're over budget on that.
There's a transfer request for that. It is because of the cost of the solar array. We have about $22,000 invoice is to pay to Attorney Marino's office for the work that they did to transfer the location of the solar array from Bethmore to Route 69.
But isn't that being refunded?
We're going to apply for it to be refunded.
No. The Senate Council will not issue a refund on that because when they basically withdrew their application, they take the decision and they'll no longer have jurisdiction.
So we will not be reimbursed on it?
Correct.
Okay. All right. That's a change.
But you don't have a solar array in anyone's backyard.
This is true.
Which is the goal.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions, Katie, on the expenses?
No, is there anything you want to highlight on the expenses that we should be looking at?
No. No. Anything on the revenues?
I think just recognizing that the state decided after the fact to increase the school ECR.
Yeah, the ECS money was $100,000 over budget because they sent us more than what we knew when we put the budget together.
That doesn't always happen. Sometimes they send us less.
That is correct. So you take the good when they're offering it. You know, and of course, I mean, our interest income was significantly higher than budgeted, but that's a good thing. But we've adjusted that in this year's budget to reflect the rates that we're currently receiving.
Now that we're about to.
Yes, and now rates are probably about to. So far, Stiff is still holding.
What?
So we'll see how long it holds.
Okay. We didn't get the Connecticut State Library grant.
Well, we did. We received the $5,500, but we also spent the $5,500. Unfortunately, historically, when the money comes in, the expenses are charged against the revenue line. I have to make an adjustment to show that we actually received that $5,500 and charge the expense somewhere else. It's an internal adjustment that I need to do.
But it will be fixed in the newness.
It will be fixed in the new system. There will be a grant income and a grant expense line to properly reflect what we are doing with those funds. All right. Next up is ARPA. There has been no change in that since July.
Can we do an ARPA request to get some telecommunication video equipment for the gym? I mean, this has been going on forever.
It is part of the HUD grant. We already have a grant in place. It's just going through the process to get the money.
Yes. The reimbursement on the HUD grant is extremely slow. It is stalled at the moment. So until they approve the expenditure reports and reimburse us, we're in a holding pattern before we can spend additional money.
This is the grant that like refurbished the gym?
Yeah, this is the one from Rosa DeLauro's office that they put through for us. And yes, the audiovisual was, although it was one of the primary reasons for doing it, it just has to be done last. So that's where we are.
On the Veterans Park Lodge, line 108, Veterans Park Lodge light upgrades and generators, it says 10,000, not enough for the project. I don't think that's a true record of what happened there.
Well, there was originally $10,000 earmarked for that project. And we pulled that money back because we knew that that was not going to be enough money to do that project. We did not spend it on that.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm mistaking it for another generator project then, perhaps. Am I mistaking it with another generator project, the one that we talked about in those
yes. Meetings? Yes, you are. That would be, that one, the one that we spoke about earlier was for Center Station.
Okay. My apologies on that one.
That's okay.
So where we are right now is mostly because of interest, as I understand it, on what we funds we've been holding. We have 17,000 that is not yet allocated or is available, and we have requests tonight for more than twice that.
Right. Correct. Right. But we're not there yet.
But we're not there yet. Right.
All right. Any other questions on the numbers? Because if not, I'd like to move on to the transfers.
Next page.
Okay. So we're looking at $84,000 to come out of contingency and be moved to three lines. One to selectmen legals to bring the selectmen department in budget for the year. An additional $13,820 to town council legal for the solar array, and $70,000 to be moved into claims and judgments.
Could you explain what the loss of the tax sales suit is?
Yes, please.
Vin, would you like to elaborate on that?
I'm happy to. Just to start the conversation, insurance defense counsel representing the town. Okay, so I did not handle the matter, but I monitored the matter, so I'm familiar with it. So judgment entered in favor of the plaintiff. The plaintiff was the property owner, who was the original, the resident, the Bethany resident who originally owned it. And by the way, if anyone wants a copy of the written decision from the court, I can email to you where I think it might even be on, it's available online through the court's website. I think it might be on the town's website also, but we can get it. So it's about 20-plus page decision. What the court found was that, so this was a serial delinquent taxpayer, okay? There came a time where the former tax collector decided to take this delinquent account and put it out for a tax sale. And the resident tried to pay the tax electronically. And what the former tax collector did was she didn't refund it. She did a check request, which she voided it, and she sent it to the lawyer handling the tax sale. So the resident never got notice, proper notice of that action. The resident got notice of the tax sale, but the court was very hard on the actions taken by the former tax collector, saying that the former tax collector kind of departed from the normal course of action and kind of went down, didn't really say that she was negligent or just kind of raised some concerns about the action. So where we stand there is the town should be paying its tax ultimately from the original owner or the successful bidder. Where the town finds itself, however, is what the court said was, well, the tax collector was the one who made the mistake, who created the situation, because she failed to let the original owner, the resident, know that she was the action she was taking with respect to the rejection of that electronic payment. And that is what set everything else in motion, that she should have never set out for tax sale because the original owner made this payment that, in the court's opinion, wasn't properly rejected by the tax collector. So what the court said is the town must repay the bidder, so the person who ultimately acquired the property through the tax sale, all their money plus 18% interest, because that's what the town would be getting on a delinquency. So kind of to penalize the town for the action of the tax collector. The former owner, the original owner, who I think it was $23,000, this electronic payment, it was in the, something in the 20s, that they had to get that money back because it wasn't properly refunded to them.
Plus
18%. And then, you know, so BL's now out of the picture. Then the resident now is responsible to pay taxes going forward. There are appeals now. So the way we were at trial court, now we're at the appellate court. And then maybe we'll go to the Supreme Court. So this may be lingering for years to come. An appeal will take about 18 months. And then if the Supreme Court takes certification, that could be another 18 months. I want you to think of those time frames because of 18% interest. Because your liability runs from the date of the judgment, which the date of the judgment runs the interest from the date of the payment, which is 2018. All right, so now the Insurance Defense Council felt that they were legitimate bases to appeal, which I didn't disagree. The court was a little, it made some factual errors. The tax collector is not responsible for the assessment of taxes, the collection of taxes. And so there were some mistakes made by the court, but I don't know if they're dramatic enough to reverse the action of the court. But what that will allow us to do is have conversations with the other side and hopefully bring this matter to a reasonable conclusion. All right, BL's out of the way. The original owner, look, this was a $600,000 house with no mortgage on it that got sold for tens of thousands of dollars. Right? Shame on the original owner for not doing their due diligence. So in my view, everyone shares their blame here. But The town has to get paid its taxes. Statutorily, there's, we are not authorized. We have no legal authority to forgive taxes. And so the court has put us in a bit of a conundrum because they've said, well, pay them back, and wait a second. I don't have this, I don't have the legal authority not to receive taxes. So what, now that there was an FOI complaint that was related to this action that I was trying to resolve with Attorney Wynn. I got that resolved today. Now I want to have a telephone conference with all the lawyers. The lawyers for BL, the lawyers for Insurance Defense, and the original residents, which I've never spoken to all of them together, just say, from the town's perspective, we have to get paid taxes. Someone's going to pay. If BL wins the appeal, congratulations, BL, you own the house, and you're going to pay the taxes. If you lose the appeal, the resident will win, right? What are we going to do here, folks? Right? Because the town should not be the one with nothing, right? Because we now you can acknowledge that it was a tax collector's fault, like the court did that. But now what? Someone's got to pay. So why should we be held in abeyance potentially for 3 years and now not charged? How do we not have the statutory, how do we have the statutory right not to collect 18% interest? So, you know, we have a bit of a legal conundrum that I'm going to have to push back on the court to say, Judge, you're going to have to enter orders to address these issues because there's, I have no statutory authority to address it. You know, so that quagmire will work out. But for purposes of your budgeting, and we, what we tried to do is say, all right, take the judgment, run it from the date that interest accrues, and then we're going to forecast it. And you'll be carrying this on your books probably until a less resolution for potentially 18 to 36 months. That's probably your time frame. And, you know, it's 1.5% interest per month that you'll accrue until it resolves. So it's the, you should have the money, the principal. You have that. It's the interest that you're going to have to budget for.
So who is actually occupying the house?
I believe the original residents never vacated.
They never vacated.
Well, they were always in possession.
And these other people have been paying the taxes for.
Well, they would take the positions that they were the owners. So that, you know.
Yeah.
How would owners do? They pay taxes.
They pay taxes. And none of theirs have been late either, because I went through.
Yes, yes, they were very good owners.
But,
so the original, are they paying taxes now?
Well, I don't believe they are. Well, and again, they're serial. We can't hold this against them.
So there's liens on their property.
Well, of course. First of all, the town gets inchoate liens automatically. Those are statutory liens that just arrive. And then every 2 years, the tax collector puts certificates continuing liens. So the town's interests by way of liens, tax liens are protected, but doesn't mean, you know, we need cash flow, right? So we get liens on everyone's property. No one pays it. The liens are going to help you pay your bills as a municipality. So ultimately, part of my conversation with Attorney Winnick also is going to be, listen, your client has been in default of their taxes multiple times. Maybe they can't afford this house. The conversation you need to have, he needs to have his client, not me. And, but, you know, I often find myself as a county attorney having conversations with residents that are difficult because people find themselves where they can no longer afford houses that they feel they can. And because it's their third, fourth, fifth, or seventh time that they're in delinquency with paying their taxes. And they have no other debt. And it's because of health. It's an unfortunate situation. Life creeps up on people. And I try as an attorney to help people with time if they can get back on their feet. But sometimes you get to a point where you just can't. And then you have to acknowledge that, and it's up to them. And if they don't acknowledge it and they don't pay it, then we'll foreclose and we will not do a tax sale again. We will do a foreclosure, judicial foreclosure through the court process. which is what my recommend. I don't recommend tax sales. I recommend judicial foreclosure. The lawyers who prefer tax sales say they're cheaper, they're more efficient, and I say, but you don't have a judge that has found notice and has entered orders. So, you know, you avoid all these issues by having the court enter orders. You know, and an average foreclosure costs anywhere from $3,500 to $5,000, and you get that back because that's part of your collection. So, anyway, so that's what that is about.
We do not know when we will have to pay this out. It could be fiscal year 25. It could be 20. It could be 27, as Vin said.
It could be 24.
But we do have the auditors. The auditors have suggested that since the original judgment was entered in the month of June, we should encumber it if we had the funds available in our 24 budget to encumber it in 24.
Okay. Makes sense.
Yeah.
Which is why I'm suggesting, and this was based off of calculations that Sharon was able to run on the interest due on the payments and hopefully budgeting, putting it out forward enough. But we also have to refund the individual that purchased it, the insurance that they have paid on this property.
Right. Yeah,
so there's a whole lot of things wrapped up in here that we...
Right. A couple things I will say we're looking into.
If the judgment stands.
A couple things we're looking into, just so everyone knows, we're doing our due diligence, is number one is we're going to see if we can offset the 18%. Because they're going to owe us 18%, we're going to owe them 18%, so those should hopefully zero out. Also, the tax collector is bonded. So we're going to see if there's a way that town can get reimbursed through that bond, right? Because that's why else, you know, some mistakes happen. People take actions, right, wrong, or indifferent. We're not here to discuss that, but there was an action taken, court found what it found. If the bond covers that action, and the town can get reimbursed through that bond, we're exploring that. So all hope is not. What else do you want to know?
You should try to read the judge's decision.
Well, I've seen some bad judge decisions.
So that's just from contingency. Then the next one listed on it.
How much is it? Was it contingency?
We started with 150.
And we never used any of it, or is this coming?
We're using it.
Is
now.
This fiscal year?
This is fiscal year 24. This
so
is.
We had 84,000 left in contingency?
Yes.
Actually. We had 124.
Well, it's a total of 124 was transferred out last year. But in this case, this is why we put that there, because you don't know what could come up. It's the unforeseen thing that you have to pay for.
Mm-hmm.
The next item on there is a recommendation to transfer $11,000 from the operating budget from the assessor for this year to the capital reserve. And that was the money that was not spent for the annual fee that I had mentioned earlier under the assessor, since it was part of the reval. That would help replenish the reval line in the capital reserve fund. And yes, there is $196,000 on the next line. It is a transfer from the unassigned general fund balance to the assigned general fund balance. Remember when we budgeted the excess money that was not spent in the region budget? that Sharon and I had explained at the budget hearing, we were going to use that to reduce the allocation for the subsequent year in the budget. But since we didn't spend that money, we're looking, the money rolled into the general fund at the end of fiscal year 23. So the object here is to move it to assign so that those funds can only be used for the purpose of education in the future, which is what they were originally appropriated for and the residents were taxed for. And the last one on there is a transfer to an unassigned number yet account because I don't know where it's going. I am playing phone tag with the new auditor. The state has changed the rules on how LOSIP is operated. They are now giving us the funds up front in the month of June. Well, they're really not giving them to us up front. They're paying out the money in June for the prior fiscal year. And you now have to, so you cannot, the funds can no longer be part of the general fund. They are recommending that they be put in a non-lapsing fund because they can only be used for capital projects. And unless you have a plan in place, long before they give you the money, you're not going to spend it in the same year that they're giving it to you. So those are the transfers that I have for fiscal year 24.
The others are previous transfers.
Everything below that are previous transfers. Those were all done.
So we need a motion to make the recommended transfers as of June 30th, 2024. A total from contingency of how much? I don't even know.
$84,530.
Oh, $84,530. Okay. We can move that. All right. Are you moving just the one or all four of them, Katie? I'm sorry, three of them.
Let's do the contingency ones together, all four of them, all three of them.
Yeah, okay. All right, do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, any discussion? All right, then a hearing now?
I have a question for clarification.
Yeah. Okay.
The total contingency date on that page includes the 84 above?
Yes.
Okay.
It is, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I know they're coming.
Okay. Those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
All right. So that was 5-0. All right. Then the capital reserve, this is actually what has been past practice is that unspent revalve funds have been put in capital so that they can be used for the next revalve. Could I have a motion to take it from the assessors online and put it into capital reserve earmarked for revalve?
I'll make that motion.
Okay.
I'll second.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Questions or comments? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Katie, thank you. 7-1. The next one is the movement of the previously appropriated AMITI funds that our previous auditor put into the unassigned general fund, and our current auditor agrees with us belongs in assigned because it's already been approved for education. Would somebody like to move that?
I will move.
Okay.
We all moved.
We're all seconding. John, keep your
sound.
All
move. It's
a picture
fit.
And the last one to.
We didn't vote on
those. Well, We did by consensus, okay. All right. The LOSIP, to now book the LOSIP into a separate account, which will be determined by our auditor because of the change in the state practice and requirements. Did I have a motion? Somebody? Thank you, John. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Martha. Discussion? All in favor? All right. Anyone opposed? Okay. Then we are finished with the transfers.
Okay.
So then the next, yeah, we did that. Okay. The next item, and this next item is sort of an information and discussion. This is not something that we have the authority to approve, because that is not our job. But this is a Bethany Parks and Recreation before and after school program. It is here with us because of the for our endorsement or lack thereof of the proposed fee structure. This fee structure comes out of our discussions during budgeting season for several years that this program should be closer to self-sustaining.
Yes. Well, how much is it subsidized?
This? Okay, I have just told you most of what I know about it. So, Jen or Leslie? It's at $4 an hour, right? Pretty much.
Well, that's the fee structure on a proposed plan is set at an hourly rate of $4 for childcare. At the current moment, the Park and Rec Department is not breaking even. It did not break even in fiscal year 24.
By how much?
Oh, a lot.
But it's important.
Yeah.
It's
like $50,000.
Is that including or not including the salaries?
Right.
How much are the salaries?
Well, if you take out the salaries for the director and the assistant director, Park and Rec made $20,000 last year. When you factor in the salaries for the director and the assistant director, it would have lost about $100,000.
And how much of that $100,000 is after school and before school? Is that all from that?
No.
No, because you've got camps and everything else.
Correct.
So how much is from the after school program?
I do not have that information.
Why?
Because the cost center information was not passed on to me.
Why?
What do you mean, cost center information?
Each individual section was considered a cost section. Like summer camp is a cost section. Before and after school is a cost section. The programs like hoops is a section. It was not broken down for the Board of Finance in the past. And it is something that was broken down with the 25 budget because I specifically said we need to have the payroll broken down by departments, we need by area, and we need to have the expenses broken down by area.
So, why was a program that was so much of a loss allowed to continue year after year without increases in you know, fees? I mean,
well, we have had those discussions with them pretty much every year, and we still were not given the information. And during this last budget process, we said, you know,
well, then we got software that supposedly
yes.
made this all wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
Well, it made it possible to get accurate revenue,
right.
information, and billing.
Right. But, and I can say that I have learned my rec in the last 3 days. So it actually is fairly comprehensive, and it allows you to track every single thing that comes in, check, credit card, whatever. Then it runs to Webster, and you can track every dollar that comes out, what people owe us, and the receipts. Like, there's the package itself is wonderful.
Give me a check. And you give me a check for balloons. Then when I get that check, I'm going to write check from so-and-so for balloons. And now she gives me a check, and it's for cupcakes. So I'm going to put that I got a check from her for cupcakes.
So the issue,
and I have a spreadsheet that tells me exactly what I got for everything.
So now, at least for the summer camp and after-school program, that is in my rec for now. That at least can be separated, reports now can be pulled. Keep in mind that only went active as meals and people. So we've only really had it active, I think like May was when, I could be wrong on that date, but it was around May that it went active for the summer. Prior to that, it was like programs were all one big lump. And so it was like hoops, after school program, when they do baking, when they do all the watercolors, all the things, it's kind of lumped into this one category, including what the cost for staff and everything else. So it was very hard for numbers to be able to calculate that way.
EXCEL.
I'm not going to argue that point. The numbers that Leslie and I talked about were based off of overhead and expenses and things like that going forward. No, for sure. But I mean, as far as going back, I think logistically it's hard to actually pinpoint a number at this point. I'm not saying that can't happen. But I'm not saying that can't happen. What I'm saying is like I've been going through their office and that information has not necessarily been located at this time. So if I come in, I haven't had the time with everything else going on to be able to pull her entire desktop to figure out if there is an Excel sheet that I haven't found yet or something like that. And if those numbers become available, for sure there will be an update.
Absolutely.
But for right now, for what we had to work with, I cannot say that.
Okay.
And I don't think Leslie could, considering that we sat down here.
There's a couple things I want to say if I could talk for a second.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead, Katie.
Okay. So first things first about, you know, like with, you know, subsidy of Parks and Rec, you know, the town pays for a lot of programs, and I think we need some strategic leadership on how we want to approach this, or we as the Board of Finance can kind of make our own decisions on how we want to subsidize Parks and Rec programs. You know, it is a valuable service to the town. I myself have 3 children, and I do use the Parks and Rec program. So just to give you perspective on what it means to me as a parent, I love these programs. Just putting that out there. There's going to be a huge butt coming on in a second, but I'm talking on the finances side right now. So I think we, the Board of Finance, need to decide what is our philosophy surrounding pricing of programs, and are we saying we, the town, going to cover the cost for the salary positions, meaning the director or the associate director or whatever this new organization becomes? Are we going to say the town will cover those, and then each program should generally be, you know, able to pay for itself? You know, that's sort of the philosophy we were tracking to before. And maybe that's how we want to price programs going forward. And maybe that's what you price out in this flyer that you included in the minute. The other part of the conversation I want to have, and which is why I actually asked for this discussion to be included in this meeting today, and it was because at the last Board of Selectmen meeting, there was a conversation about possibly moving the after-school program, which I do think is a necessary a need for parents in town to have an after-school care program. I thought that was being transferred to the school, and I think that might be appropriate while the Parks and Rec department gets revamped and they decide how they want to run and things like that. I don't see it making a lot of sense to run two programs at the school and with Park and Rec. That seems like nonsense to me, so I don't understand where this is coming from. And if we did continue with the school program while the Parks and Rec Department does the divisioning and while we hire consultants to, brainstorm how the town wants the Park and Rec Department to, meet the needs of families, maybe we could take extra funding from salaries or, we can exercise to find funding to fill that gap for what the families that were accepting after school program are now, having to pay for with a safe increase in expense for the school program. But at this point of record, I was in this position, I was budgeting to have consider pricing for after school care of $210 a month per kid. But they also all sorts of discounts for extra kids if you're using some account. And so the school hasn't come up with their pricing yet, and it's not finalized. Of course, we don't know all the details about it. But I don't understand why there's two programs, and I think we should just do one of those. Park and Rec. I want it to provide all sorts of care, but I think it needs to stand up with the visioning, identify the needs for the town. And then after they've identified the needs of the town, staff or create policy. I don't think that this request today is for any sort of funding for training. I don't know what extra training are going to be provided for the counselors if they have any training. So I don't fully understand what we're doing today with this, other than looking at the fee structure and maybe having that philosophical conversation about what the town wants to pay for versus what the residents and the users of the service are expected to pay.
Katie, just so you know, I did meet with Kay Burr the day after the Board of Selectmen meeting last week, as I had been instructed or requested to do, and we had quite a productive conversation. She could not guarantee that she would be able to have any kind of program running for the beginning of school, which is, about a week and a half from now. So we have, Jen has been working, Leslie, Sharon, Nick, furiously to put this together so that parents, because that was one of the concerns. I got multiple people last week wanting to know what was going to happen for the first day of school. So, and I told, I will continue the conversation with Kay. It wouldn't be the first time that some programs have run simultaneously at the school and the Park and Recs department. But the form will be going out to the families. I'm hoping by tonight. Jen was working furiously with my rec because they were trying to put some kinks out of it, because there were so many pieces that had to be put into my record, like holidays, half days, who's doing, having the selection of just before school or just after school or the combination of both. So it took some work to put everything together. But for the parents that reached out that were concerned about the first day of school, and Kay, was pretty clear that there was no guarantee that she'd be able to have anything up and running, because she has to figure out how to do staffing, what are the contractual issues, what are her space issues, numerous pieces that had to be considered for them to put the program. Was it impossible to do it, just the logistics of it, to do it within a 2-week period? Staff isn't even back yet until next week, so she would have to address that with staffing as well. Because if there isn't staff in-house that wants to do it, then how do you advertise and train for staff that's outside?
A short-term program until the school program's up and running?
We don't know. We'll have this continued conversation. I don't know what
kind of interest. Apparently, there was some kind of survey that was sent out to parents. So I don't know what kind of response she got with that. I don't have, you know, children at the school, so obviously I didn't get a survey, so I have no idea what that entailed, how extensive it was. So I don't know what the results of that survey were at her end, so I don't know. But in fairness to the families that reached out concerned about the first day of school, that's why we're putting this forward, and it will be a continued conversation with Kay. We don't know what kind of interest will be if the school comes up. So that's pretty much where we are at this point. I'm sorry.
When it says counselors, it says our staff of after school counselors will work to not only monitor and supervise children, blah, blah, blah. Who are those counselors? Where did they come from?
Sure. So the idea is moving forward that we're assessing need and putting out external applicants so that it's not just, you know, kind of the people who have homegrown throughout the system and to kind of pick people who have certifications or qualifications that, you know, whatever we're looking for that position. So if it's just a regular counselor, obviously most of that pool is going to come from the high school people in college. That's typically what the counselors are. You may have senior counselors, depending on if it's after school program, if it's a summer program, but for this particular, you're most likely looking for college age kids for the after school program as far as like the nighttime, but possibly going to be high school. Also, Nick, who is does have a master's in social work, he will be here
every day.
So the plan is that he's working full time right now, though he is an hourly employee. He has not been making full time. He's just an interim director, but that was part of the, I don't want to jump ahead, part of the consult to come in and decide based off of our program need and everything else to see what positions are needed for there so that we can hire appropriately. But I think that what's going to happen is based off of the numbers of people who register, you know, we're going to have to look at what the need is and how many people we need to bring in. And we'll assess that once we know what our registration looks like. Currently, right now, we have enough people who have experience, who are currently either getting updated training or have gotten basic training, but we're going to up that. But again, we're going to be looking at what the needs are going forward.
So is Nick giving up all the coaching at the middle school?
As far as I know right now, he could still do the coaching because we would not expect him to do 16-hour days every day. But coaching is, I guess, from 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock or something like that, 2:30 to 4:30. So he can take that as a break and come back and close up. And we do have other senior staff that are still here as long as they're properly trained, but they need to be properly trained first.
How this would work is not in front of us. I just want to be clear about that because that is not our
no, I know it's not
our purview.
But again, if we're asked to support something, I'm not going to support something if I'm not sure how it works and
yes.
how safe it is and how well trained the people are and how I'm not. I'm a mandatory reporter. There's no way I'm getting involved in anything that I don't know.
Well,
but again, I have a problem with the money.
Okay.
Because again, if it's coming out to $4 an hour for childcare,
mm-hmm.
you know, who are you going, I mean, and I don't know what we pay, but we're setting ourselves up for losses. We have extra legal fees now, we have a lot of expenses coming up, and this is just going to pile on top of it.
It was my understanding, and I'm going to verify this, that the $4 an hour came out of the expected, came from the expected costs. Yes?
Tell me if I'm wrong, I don't want to speak for you. I believe that the idea this year is to break even. It's not to make money, it wasn't to be a profit, it was to cover basic expenses and not be a loss. That being said, we don't really know who's registered yet, and we don't know to what extent. So until we know that, but the idea, excuse me, the idea was based off of the ratios that you can have a counselor to child and knowing that, you know, we have two counselors to every, you know, every group, you know, that's what we based it off of. So
So that would suggest that anything lower than this would be expected to be, well, less than $4 an hour. These rates.
What do you think, like, council?
And then, one more thing, and maybe that's fair right now to the residents who have, you know, budgeted a certain price point. And maybe, you know, we can make expectations for future, but I think we need to have a philosophy on what part of Parks and Rec we are going to subsidize. And it can't just be like, well, we'll figure it out when we get there, you know? So without direction from, you know, leadership, I think we as Board of Finance, we decide what we are going to request these programs, you know, what profit we expect them to carry, and none, if that's what we said. And I think that's acceptable, you know, like, we do provide services to our residents, and I certainly think, you know, continuing with salaried employees, not being part of the program costs, you know, things like that. And, you know, but breaking even is great if that's what we're looking for.
I guess I can't figure out how you can set up a fee if you don't have all the other information. How many counselors minimum do you need? How much are we paying them per hour? And until you know that, so you know what your basic weekly expense is, I don't see how you can set a program fee.
So we agree with that.
This was a joint effort.
Sure.
What we're looking at on this is it's 80 if you before and after school. It's $80 per week. By four is $240 a month. Last year it was $210 a month, and you only had to pay for the after school. You weren't charged for the before school, or maybe you were. We don't know. We can't.
And more than that, you weren't charged for snow days. You weren't charged for holidays. It was all built in. Like, it was this, like, if you signed up for after school and, you know, the school went out early, you didn't have to pay extra for those extra 2 hours. If the school had a PD day and, you know, there was no school that day, it was just kind of part of the after school program that you came and there's no extra cost there. Now there is. There's a built-in cost for if it's all day. You know, you get this, you know, it's this rate. If you're, you know, just the after school, it's this rate. If the school is out 2 hours earlier, there's an $8 additional charge for the $4 per hour. So now you have another rate. And it's built in, right? I did all that in my rec. So that way the people that are signing up for week, they don't do all those calculations. I already did them all. They're in there. They just have to pick the week and it'll show what rate they have for that week based off of what the school has as a calendar. But I think some of it too, and Leslie, please tell me if I'm wrong. Some of it is based off of this as well as, I think Park and Rec has done a decent job at in their supply area right now. So their expense line would not be as high as it has been. So the idea is this year in particular to make sure that we're vetting out some of these things is to use what we have for supplies and see if we can run some of that. So we can kind of balance out if we need to, if our rates are not as high as we have expected them to be. But that's the plan is to make sure that they balance out at the end of the year, this year, and then moving forward, we can actually have real numbers to see, you know, what's going on in that area.
One of the other things that we looked at is if a family was used to paying $200 a month, going to $300 was an unrealistic expectation. So we tried very hard to come up with reasonable across the board rates, not making the morning or the afternoon more expensive, keeping the cost even. And you can put, the ratios are 6 or 10 students per counselor, but we would not do that. We would have two, wherever it's, if whatever the ratio, the acceptable ratio is, we factored in doubling that. So if I mean, if there's 40 kids, that says you need 4 counselors. We based it off of 8 counselors or 10. So that there were always 2 present with the children at all times. There's even talk about having a hall monitor the entire time. You know, just different changes, different things, and we try to factor all that cost in when we came up with the rates. It's not an exact science.
One of the concerns I have is that the price thing, you know, Judy is still and helping with, you know, the finances, I think it's important that you're contributing, but I think, you know, we need someone who knows what we need in order to help guide the pricing. You know what I mean? Like, it's very concerning. It's not really well conceived. But I understand the time crunch and there's no other options for parents. I mean, I don't even empathize there. I sympathize. I'm in that position. I have the same emotion, you know? So I know this is to discuss the pricing. I'm just concerned that we're making these decisions without, you know, the direction of someone who, you know, familiar with human resource strategies associated with after camp programs.
And that's where consultants could be helpful.
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the things that we can do is that we can take no action. All that we've been doing anyway would have been making a comment on the pricing structure. One of the things that is out there is that we have the advice of counsel to hire a consultant to do a review and make recommendations in terms of changes in policies and procedures. But that's for Park and Rec, not just morning and afternoon. There's the whole department. The Board of Selectmen did not act on that recommendation at their last meeting. I think that we need to do something because obviously in a week and a half there needs to be something. There needs to be a guarantee of something out there.
I think that means tomorrow.
Then, okay.
Well, I'm just saying, you know, we have no idea whether a plan is being put in place or not. So with the Board of Ed meeting tomorrow, and the understanding I have is it's going to be discussed. That is this premature to go out tonight?
That's not us.
That they can get their kids registered. That's a week and a half to do it. We can't delay this anymore. We were hoping to get it out sooner, actually, but obviously trying to make sure all the pieces were put in place, especially with my rec, because that's where they're going to register. We need to make sure that that is properly set up so that it wouldn't frustrate people on the other end when they're trying to go in and register the child. So
Nick is the interim director.
Correct.
Who else is employed by Park and Rec at this point?
Well, there's a series of counselors that are in place. Jen does payroll. I mean, she knows how many.
That are year round?
No.
So how many year round employees do we have?
It varies. Right now, what I can tell you is this. I can't tell you how Janice did it. I don't know how she reached out to people or gathered how many people or what have you. What I have asked is Nick to put together, get them together because next week is last week, and I asked him to have it to me by Monday of who is planning on staying, what level they're at, how long they've been here, what certifications they've already completed, so that way anything I have to fill the gaps in, we can start doing that before obviously summer camp ends, you know, before the next program starts and again refresher. That's really what we can do right now. And then I have based off of these numbers, if we don't have enough, you know, senior folks, we will have to, you know, figure out what we're going to do there. Is there going to be external, see what the high schools have, see if there's other, you know, kids that did camp programs who want to come over to, you know, ours after school, what have you. I mean, those things we're going to have to vet. But first, we just need the numbers, figure out the numbers.
So, right now, Nick is the only adult person.
Nick, yep, and I have been helping him pretty much the entire week since he's been here.
How many college kids work here?
Right now, there are, I believe there's six or seven. And it depends on vacations, just like any other summer camp. You know, the kids come in, they do, it's young adults, come in, they do, you know, 3 weeks or 2 weeks, and they have a summer vacation, they come back, they do another 2 weeks, and then, you know, they might not finish out or whatever. So they ebb and flow depending on how many family vacations they have.
So of those seven, you have no idea if any of them want to do football?
At this point, I do not. So I will find that out by next week.
All right, what do we want to do with this? Because we need to move on. Obviously, none of the granular details are for us to determine. Jen has been working her butt off, trying to pull together things that need to pull together. It's a tremendous amount of work. I want to recognize that. And Leslie and Jen make an awfully good team. If we do not want to make any comment on that structure, then I think the only thing we can do with it is move it on to the Board of Selectmen without a comment. I would have liked for us to make a comment one way or the other, but if we're not going to, that's the only thing that we can make a comment on. I understand that everything depends on something else, depends on something else, depends on something else, and it's going around in circles. But we the Board of Finance cannot solve this.
The only thing I would say, Sharon, about the price, that's the area you're looking for comment on, I can say that I like the Parks and Rec to just try to be, cost neutral as much as they can.
Okay.
Perhaps, this grace period of this year, as people have maybe prepared their, you know, budgets for school year, maybe we could, you know, relax that requirement a bit, since people were perhaps paying a lower amount at a subsidized budget price. But that's the only comment I guess I'll make about the pricing perspective. That's just my personal recommendation, speaking as a Board of Finance member.
Okay. All right. Thank you. So there are two parts to that. One is that it should be trying to be
It should be what?
Trying to be self-supporting,
mm-hmm.
but that maybe it doesn't all get implemented this year.
With the exception of any salary positions, I think that should be under, in my opinion, as a Board of Finance member, I think that should be part of the town budget.
Next year. Because this year's budget is already in place.
Yeah, thank you. But not in the calculations of whether or not a program, they shouldn't be charged as an overhead, if you will, to a program cost.
Okay.
In determining its possibility.
The good news is that with this year just starting, we're in a position to have more influence over the record keeping process, so that we will have better information by the time the budget process begins again, so that we'll be able to make an educated and informed decision on that. Okay. Anyone? Would someone like to make a motion, or are we just not going to?
I'm not comfortable with the town starting up the program or continuing the program when there's no guarantee that an adult, a responsible adult, is going to be on the premise.
Okay.
I don't think parents are gonna like that. I don't know that I would send my child to an after-school program that had no responsible adult on the premise. And that's my opinion.
I'm not disagreeing with
no,
you.
I'm saying this
is not.
This is, you know, that's
part of
what
we're doing.
It's not.
It's
well,
an individual
comment, and I'm giving my comment.
I meant about the part that is our purview.
Which is the fees, and I think the fees are. I understand, you know, making it affordable to families, but not at the expense of being $100,000 in debt for the town. Because it doesn't benefit the entire town, it benefits a small segment of the town. And I'm not dismissing how important it is to that segment and how it should be safe and affordable. But again, you know, it's a burden to everyone if it's the prices are so low or the cost is so low that the town is subsidizing future costs. So that's my opinion on that.
Well, we don't have, unfortunately, we do not have those numbers for historically because they would not give them to us.
And we don't even have it now because we have no idea how many people are going to enroll.
Right.
So we don't know what the revenue is to offset expenses.
Right.
So to me, it's kind of like half-assed.
So we can, I think a lot of thought went into it, but.
I'm not saying it didn't go into it.
Okay. All right, John, comment? Anything?
I just think the whole structure could change based on the evaluation of the program.
Right, it could.
So I understand both sides. I agree with Sally, and at the same time, the parents have no plan on this kind of notice.
Mm-hmm.
So it is definitely difficult predicament here. I just think without the evaluation, and I think an adult has to be on the premises, I'm a little confused with if this person leaves from 2 to 4:30, who's running the show when he goes coaches? That makes no sense to me at all. If you're going to take the program, he's got to make a decision, or we got to say, this is what you've got to decide.
Or you got to hire a responsible
adult. Or you got to replace
him. And I just want to clarify that based off the numbers, we could externally hire somebody if the program continues to run. We're nobody's saying that we wouldn't hire somebody else before he was allowed to do that. That's why I was trying to say they have the proper certification. There's things in there, you know, obviously there's mandated reporting. There's certain trainings that have to take place. There's somebody that has to be CPR, you know, certified at all times. There's just different things that have to qualify. So having an adult there, depending on, you know, what your definition of that is, if it's a 22-year-old or a 26-year-old or, you know, depending on what your definition of adult, right, or expertise is something different.
So we're going to start this in a week and a half. So what if we don't have any of these people coming back of the set?
There will be some that come back. They always do. We have some people that are about 25, 26 years old. They've come back for about 10 years.
Are we going to have enough? Or what if we don't have enough, what's going to be the plan?
Sure. And I think the first thing, though, is we need that to get those numbers, to get the answer, is it has to be, you know, you have to be able to allow people to register and have, you know, and be able to sign up
so
or something.
So you have 3 days for that.
And what are we paying?
What are we paying? The counselors?
Hmm.
Right now, the way the structure's set up is dependent on how long they've been here. So we have some folks that are minimum wage, and those are typically the younger, you know, just starting out. We have some that are upwards to $18, $19 an hour. And those are the ones that have been here since they were like 15 years old and, you know, they've gone through all the way through college.
Okay. All right, are we going to do anything with this, or are we just going to pass it along? I think everybody has good points, but as I said before, the problem is that it's circular and everything depends on something else that hasn't been decided yet, I would suggest that we take no action on it, that if we can summarize the comments that were made and pass them along, that that might be informative for whoever is going to deal with this after us. Does that work? Oh, Katie, does that work for you?
Yes, it works for me.
Okay, thank you. And Jen, do you have enough information for that? Okay. All right, then we're going to move on. Okay. And thank you, everyone. This is one you can't win. You can't win no matter what you do. Okay, so let's see. Munis.
Well, there's a bunch of informational items, but I will elaborate on if someone needs more information than what is printed on the agenda.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's, well, the beaver issue.
Well, we covered three. Yeah, there's a beaver issue on Mesa Drive, and there's money encumbered from 24, but the project could cost three times what we encumbered because they're saying it's a massive problem.
Lots of beavers.
That was Mesa Drive, then not me.
Okay. Do we have an estimate yet?
The first number thrown, the last number thrown out to Public Works was over $6,000. There's $2,600 encumbered. Well, but we have not seen engineered instructions to fix it.
$6,000 is not massive.
Well, compared to. Well, it's
probably.
But that does not include an engineering assessment of it.
Say that, you just said 6,000.
We don't know.
So we really don't know.
It'll.
So what is it doing? Are they flooding the area?
Yeah.
Pretty impressive, actually.
Well, I was on Mason Drive the other day. I didn't notice any.
They built their dams.
You have to go down by where the road goes on.
Where the beavers are.
My grandpa on Mason Drive, I didn't see.
In the depression down by the bridge.
Ah. Okay. Right. I'll take a better look.
So I think she's just alerting us to the fact that it's
it could become raising its ugly head or tail.
Correct. And it could cause a line to go over budget.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
ARPA.
Grants, ARPA. As we established on the spreadsheet, there's about $17,000 in available money. In the packet, there was a proposal for AED devices. Sorry, Katie, you don't have this. There was also a request sent to me today from the Historical Society for a new floor in the museum at the cost of $18,000 and new windows at the homestead at a price of $10,000.
And the AEDs are going, the defibrillators, where, how many different places?
There are seven of them. It's a total of seven AED units. They would be one for the lodge, the pavilion, center station, the annex, the DPW garage, the recycling center, and a second unit for town hall.
Okay. So these are all going to happen anyway. I saw something about a coupon.
Yes. Yes, there is a coupon that we can take $400 off each unit.
Oh, each unit?
Yes, okay. At the moment, through the American AED.
Okay.
Is there an installation date?
So, thing from Stryker for the Bethany Fire Department that happens to be for the same thing is with same thing?
It is, but it's more expensive. But that's one of the quotes.
Okay. Also, this is a quote.
It's a quote. Yeah, there's a whole bunch. Don did his due diligence for me. He obtained three or four quotes on it. He actually had, there's actually four of them here.
I'm going to get a free kitchen.
I like the coupon. You know, I said to him, I said, well, if you need them, I need three cups. Because it's going to be more than $5,000, probably more than $10,000. I said, and if it's 20, we're going out to bid. He goes, I'm going to find a way to keep it under 20. And he did his due diligence for us. He did come up with a bunch of price quotes. Now, we do have Linda Wooster in attendance tonight. If she would like to elaborate on the Historical Society needs before we, you know, since we're, the floor is open to discuss the three projects.
Well, and I apologize for the last minute request, but as you know, trying to get bids is not easy, and making appointments and having them not show up or whatever is difficult. We have done our due diligence, to use the term, as far as getting estimates. And it's funny because I was just making notes. Our quiet little historical society is quickly becoming a rather intrinsic part of Bethany's community and culture. We're doing programs with the school. We have the second graders come every year. We have, they requested curriculum guides from us. We do two or three programs with them during the summer with their special needs students. We have senior citizens coming. We have, the past 3 years, we've increased our programs from 4 to 16. Which for us is a tremendous increase. And for example, our cemetery tour, our Halloween cemetery tours, started out with 20, 30 people. They're now up to 85, 86 people, and really moving toward 100. The word is out. Our open houses went from maybe 20 people, the open house at either the Russell Homestead or the museum. And there are now over 150 people coming with the addition of hay rides and interactive children's activities, to use the word activity two times in a row. Our budget is basically for recycling cans and bottles. So we get our basic operating budget from that venue, which is not as easy as it appears to the normal eye. It does take quite a bit of work. The town has been very, very good to us with ARPA funds, granting us money to do some capital projects. And we figured we'd give it a go and try and get a 26-year-old carpet that was originally purchased with the least amount of money possible, and is water stained and ripped. I did include some pictures in the proposal, and it really doesn't do it justice. It's sort of embarrassing, but we strategically placed chairs over some of the discoloration and rips. We're very creative, we're very frugal. So that we make do with what we have. We really do get the most for our money. We work very, very hard for it. And groups are now coming to us to request our services. Land Trust requested Will Brin do a historical tour last weekend. We've got Catherine Oshwick teaching special needs. How to make paper and use quills during the summer. We're branching out to learn how to can tomatoes and made salsa program, which filled up so fast we couldn't believe it. So we're doing that from a historical perspective. And so we're a very quiet entity there, hopefully not controversial. And we're just making a request for new flooring. These requests were meant to be separate, because just from ours, when you complete a project, sometimes there is money remaining, which comes back to the ARPA funds, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
So we were trying to get in on the top level, and if there were any, don't laugh at me, Leslie, I worked real hard
at this. I'm not laughing at you. Not at all.
So that we can hopefully get a new flooring. And part of the cost is, quite frankly, $2,500 for moving our file cabinets and our display cabinets. We have a tremendous number of them, and so that is built into the price. So if going over a certain amount is an issue, I'll get the furniture moved one way or the other. if you could see approving the request for four. So that's my pitch. The 10 windows in the Russell Homestead, which is where we're holding more and more programs for the community school kids. And I don't know if anybody has had a second grader in the past year or two, but
ooh, you copy.
Let me tell you, we keep those kids hopping. Mm-hmm. The old girls keep those kids hopping every 15 minutes. Candle making, peeling apples, planting, making butter, taking a 15-minute tour, and one child is enamored with the cellar of the Russell Homestead, where all the canned goods and where the animals. The meat was stored under the floor in the icebox. So it really is a learning experience from days going by. And we would just appreciate your support. And, again, the requests were meant to be separate. I would never turn down a joint allocation of money. But I figured I would give it a try.
Okay, so what we have in front of us are one, the flooring for $18,200, one for windows of 10, basically 10,000, and one for seven defibrillators for 17,000? No, for 14,000. And we have $17,000. That's what's left. So, the defibrillators, can we do them out of a current budget line? That is not our budget. Probably not. But I could look at the rules, and it's possible that they would fall under LOSIP grant eligibility. Okay. I assume time is of the essence for the coupons? Correct. And what is our time frame for the coupons? We do not know. Don's reaction was it could be here today, gone tomorrow. Because when I went on the look, there was a back-to-school special of 200 per unit.
Oh.
But yet, the 400 still showed up when I put them in the cart. So, I don't know.
This is just okay. So many
hundreds. So yeah. All right. So, what I'm seeing is there is no other way than ARPA to help the Historical Society at this point in time. The...
And no, that not the $10,000, no.
Doesn't it have to go before town meeting?
No, none of them are of that.
But isn't like historical society, isn't that like really one entity that's going to be over $20,000?
Only if we give them both. They're two separate requests. She was very clear, they're two separate requests.
So we're back to like generator electric plant panels. We're gonna kind of slide it in this way, slide it in that way, and it comes into over $20,000.
No.
But we're not going to have.
No, because even just the laminate flooring exceeds the amount we have available. So we can't give them both, both. We cannot do both. I would suggest that basically with what we have left, we either have to choose an alternative way to fund the defibrillators, because they obviously have to happen. And there are probably multiple ways to do that out of our existing budget, including from the contingency line if that's what it takes. But that there is no alternative at this point to ARPA for assisting the Historical Society with their work.
One important thing that was, there was a $10,000 line item in the budget when it looked like recycling was going to go away.
Right.
And it was a one-time stipulation to make up for our budget allotment. We have no intent on requesting that $10,000, much to my old Yankee stingency. We have no intention of requesting that $10,000. So
you have your cans and bottles.
We do have, which have quite frankly gone down, even though the price of 10 cents is now per can and bottle. People are returning their own cans and bottles for and if you ever visit these recycling centers that take
like
you would not believe the lines out the door.
We've done the most.
I know, and let's get like across both the people.
So is that $10,000 still in the budget?
Yes, that line item is in there, but its sole purpose was to replace income lost with the
Candle bottles.
Mm-hmm.
Closing
the recycle. Yes, closing the recycle. And since that didn't happen, okay, so I'm kind of in between on this. In part because of obviously the public safety issue involved with the defibrillators, and also the fact that the Historical Society has benefited significantly from ARPA and with other improvements to their building. On the other hand, we do have alternatives for funding the defibrillators. So that's my thoughts. Anybody?
So you're saying, if I understand you correctly, that we would use the ARPA funds toward the historical
society, towards the war.
And come up with the rest of the money from contingency or whatever.
No, not for that. For the defibrillators.
The ARPA is the defib.
No. The ARPA is the floor for the Historical Society, and we find in our operating budget funds for the defibrillators. Or we can do it we can't do it the other way around. So that's why it's early in the year, I realize, to be spending what might be a contingency line. I think we absolutely have the obligation to purchase these defibrillators. They are ARPA eligible. We have, on the other hand, this is our last opportunity to benefit other public agencies with the ARPA funds.
Well, if you put $17,000 towards the floor, there might be another way to get our, another grant or something for these.
Well,
or we just.
Possibly LOSA.
Okay.
Which would not, yeah, we are, we're gonna get the money upfront, right, for the LOSA? Yeah, so.
And what if LOSA says no? Then we've spent the ARPA money and we don't have the funds.
Right, that's what I said, it is, it's a decision. Do we fund that from our, the defibrillators from some other line item in our budget? And give the ARPA funds to the Historical Society? Or do we use, basically, either way, it's gonna all be gone. Or do we buy the defibrillators with the ARPA money and have nothing to help the Historical Society? Just, it's a, really a simple, this relatively simple decision. What is your preference? What do you think our chances are with LOSA?
With the new rules for LOSA, you must submit your capital plan to the state, and your capital plan must have the item that you want reimbursed on, and you must have it labeled that it is to be funded with grant money.
Okay. Except that it's too late to submit the plan for this year because
correct.
We didn't know about this.
Correct. Year. The money now rolls. So we can submit. So when we, so what we're thinking here to budget season, when we set our budget, we need to label our capital plan with what projects we want to fund with LOSA money.
But meanwhile, we can access, because that rule was not in effect on July 1st.
Yes, it was.
Or, I'm sorry, in May when we adopted our budget.
Correct.
Then we could not have done that.
Correct. Then, but the $68,000 that they gave us in June is subject to those rules.
No. Oh, she's trying to call back.
Oh, she's trying to call back.
We already lost this.
Hello.
Hello? 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 Hello?
Katie?
Okay. All right. So we have a catch 22 with LOSA, so we're not actually going to be able to spend it?
The $68,000 this year? Probably not. So we will have $135,000 to spend next year.
Katie?
Hi, this is voicemail for Katie Erickson.
Okay.
Apparently, it reversed and called her instead of us answering. And
oh, wow.
So we'll try that again. Another shot.
But it was a. Okay.
Yeah.
Reverse. All right. On the other hand, we have a surplus from last year.
Yes.
Of course, we may need all that money. We haven't even got to that yet. What do you want to do here?
Hi, this is Monica.
I don't think she realizes she got disconnected.
So, well, then just wait for her to call us back.
Okay.
I'm leaning towards helping the Historical Society.
You're leaning towards helping the Historical Society. Okay. Salad?
Me for E.
Here. John?
Where do we stand with the decorators? Was it just a request and that's it?
We have to buy them anyway. No, they just.
There are buildings that don't have it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All these buildings don't have. No, they're not mandated there, I don't think, but they're an awfully good idea.
Katie, are you there? Katie?
One of them.
I just know when I was teaching, we ended up getting them and it was, I think it was almost because we were stored, we had to, because there were, because the building, I don't know whether it's because there were kids in it, I don't remember why, but.
But there is one in this building.
There's one in this building.
There's one in this building, that's all that.
There's, in the school they have one.
Yes. But having them in all the other buildings.
Town buildings, I, you know, I don't think it's a bad thing at all.
No. John? Which way?
Well, we did one with one and then the other one with contingency.
Mm-hmm.
He would do them all both?
Yes, we can do them both.
So, then that's where I go.
Okay, so you are essentially agreeing with Martha that we would do the ARPA and award it to the Historical Society for that floor. I agree with that primarily because A, I think we're going to do the defibrillators anyway because we really need to. And also because I know that because of both a reduction in expenses and an increase in revenues, we did come up with a pretty nice looking surplus again. And although, of course, we've increased our budget because of the recycling center for more than what we tax people for, but nevertheless, I think I support awarding the ARPA funds to the Historical Society for the floor.
I'm still trying to get Katie.
We need what?
I'm still trying to get Katie for you.
Motion? Motion for, we're almost done.
I did the motion.
The phone probably died.
Yeah, that's.
It's possible there's connection.
Or is there having some s'mores? Lots of possibilities.
I have looked up the allowable projects under the new LoCIP grant. Roads, sidewalk and pavement, sewage treatment plants, sanitary or stormwater or sewer line, public buildings other than schools, construction, renovation, code compliance, energy conservation, and fire safety.
Code compliance? Fire safety? Public health? Did it include public health?
It says public buildings other than schools, construction, renovation, code compliance, energy conservation, and fire safety.
So public buildings need to have these.
Code compliance. Okay, so, well, let me.
That would be code compliance.
There's still more. Dams, bridges, flood control, water treatment or filtration facilities, solid waste facilities, public parks, capital improvement plans, emergency communication systems, building security systems, including schools, public housing, veterans memorials, thermal imaging systems, bulky waste landfill projects, conservation and development plans, auto external defibrillators, the acquisition of them, floodplain management and hazardous mitigation activities.
So there we go.
Yes, the AEDs are under LoCIP.
Okay. So therefore, we can do both and not spend any of our money.
That's why it falls under LOSIP, it's a capital improvement plan.
In the.
Even in the grant proposal.
And it specifically calls out the timber.
It does.
I heard the bins, I think, for the leaders.
Yeah, we can do that by LOSIP.
I know, because they build dams and they cause flooding, and I mean, you know, and.
I don't know.
I'm just saying.
All right, the hazardous tree removal is also on the LOSIP plan. Yes, that would.
Well, the beavers are already doing that.
They're not taking the really big ones, you know?
Well, maybe they don't taste well, maybe we need to do something.
We have to point them in the right direction. Okay, could I have a motion?
I move that we use the remaining ARP funds for the Historical Society floor and LOSIP funds for the purchase of 7 ATVs.
Different layers, huh?
Different layers.
Do you like that? And the second with Mark. Those in favor?
Aye.
I'm sorry we couldn't help with the windows, but you won't have to cover the messes.
We tried to cover an open house, we were very creative.
Right.
Okay.
I have been.
Katie totally lost service.
Yes, I just tried.
Oh, okay. That explains. All right, let's see, where are we next? Is this the proposed grant committee?
Next, or is it me? Well, I say that we skip over all the informational items under grants.
Okay.
Because it's just information. And we move to the chairman's report.
All right.
Which says, Sharon, that means you're up with the grant.
Okay.
The grant?
That's what you said it was.
But no. I said it was 27.
Oh, no, I didn't, I was wrong. It is next week on Monday.
Oh, okay.
Because when I looked at their, calendar, there was no meeting last night. And I looked, and the Board of Ed was meeting on the 27th. The Finance Committee will be meeting next Monday.
Okay.
For what it's worth, they are currently showing a 990-something $1,000 surplus, which is less than the 2%. So they're gonna.
Did you see the agendas?
Sharon, not that they don't keep it all anyway, but.
Did you see the agenda? Because I think I gave you a copy where it said they're looking to set up an educational reserve.
Oh, yeah, I was about, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, okay. But the state law has changed. The law that lets them take up to 2%, but it had to be allocated to specific capital projects, has been changed, and they can now just set up an educational reserve that can be used for unassigned capital projects or operations spending instead of having to be pre-identified.
Or approved.
Or approved projects. And it means they can use it for operating costs. And so they are asking for us to approve their using that process, which basically means they get to keep it and they don't have to tell anybody what they're going to do with it. Oh, well, for this year, it's $990,000, but they can keep up to 2% of the approved expenditure budget, which is one of the reasons to keep kicking that budget up.
So they're asking if they can do it. What if we say no?
Well, I just want to point something here, because I'm starting to say this at every board. We may not like it, but if it's the law and they're compliant with the law, we've all taken oaths in our positions to uphold the laws of the state. So you may have, you can express your frustration, you can express your concerns, but if it's the law and they're following the law, your acknowledgement or your assent is really not necessary.
right?
Oh, no, she's asking the Board of Ed to change their policy.
Yeah, she's, but, yeah, but really, we're actually.
They mind if we do that, and I think we should say, yes, we do mind.
Right, but if their law allows them to, right?
See, and I think there should be a groundswell of.
Then go to ARPA.
Ask for your budget, and your budget is approved, and then you have $1 million or $2 million surplus, your budget can be reduced by that the next year.
And I agree with you 100%.
Need it.
I agree with you 100%.
And if not, then I think that for the next 4 or 5 years, we only approve a zero budget.
I agree with you 100%, but as I said to the person.
You don't need the money.
As I said to the person who was opposed to cannabis, we're not here to discuss cannabis, we're here to discuss the opening of a retail establishment. That was addressed in Hartford. And you need to go and discuss it with your senator, your representative, and change the law. But I agree with you 100%, by the way. But, you know, and the frustrating part of it is they don't treat municipality the same way they treat the Board of Education, right? But in the way that we're, our finances could be self-managed, and we're the ones funding.
And I understand why they did it. I understand when towns started having financial issues, they were pulling from education, and education was failing. And I get that. But again, you know, they shouldn't be able to
treat
the town like they
do. So I would say you can express your frustration, but if you vote against it, you're kind of voting against the law. So that's your point.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we don't get to vote. They're asking the Board of Education to change the policy.
So
I'm just letting you know.
Right. So you can't tell them not to change the policy.
No, you don't tell them anything that that's pretty.
Exactly. And even reduce their budget.
Yeah.
That's what you should tell them.
Well, I know. What they need is another cent of operating expenses. Anyway. The grant committee that we've wanted to get going. So originally I had said that I would reach out, only then we were doing another one of these goes around, comes around. And Jen did an awesome job. This is an item that's for discussion on September 10th, but there's a document here where she collected all kinds of mission statements and operational statements and forms and stuff that is not a recommendation. It's just a bunch of stuff for us to go through and pick what we think are the right things that we ought to be doing. And yeah, yeah. How did I do it, especially with the audio?
I like the audio. That sounds good.
That's the one template is one that you actually have to use on one of the grants, correct?
Yeah.
So what every grant has a different template. So what I did was I took one that was actually when I did something with a group, it was a trip grant, and I had Scrog, I reached out to Scrog, and this is something they gave me as like a preliminary checklist before you apply to a grant, what you should do once you apply to the grant, what should happen once you're waiting, once you get approved, all the things. And so this just kind of gives you an overall of like, if you're not prepared, or if you don't have, you know, the right resources before going into this, you know, should you be applying for that grant? And if you apply for that grant, understand that these are all the parameters that might be coming along, you know, once you start the process. So by no means is this something that we have to use. I was just giving it as an example of like something that we should create that works for Bethany to you know, check off all the boxes before we decide to do something.
And it's incredibly thorough.
Mm-hmm.
It would be incredibly aspirational for us, but anyway, September 10th, we will set aside time. Okay, the next one, the potential funding for a management review consultant as recommended by the town attorney. Okay, so this is the one that we mentioned earlier that and that again, Jen checked with our the different organizations that we're members of to see who they had, and came up with one, and one, you know, from CCM, and our Board of Selectmen were not happy with the credentials presented, and now she's found potentially another one, and that'll go forward. Our job will be to provide funding. Now, the first one recommended, what did he say?
He was in seven.
Nine to 20?
No, so what he said was, if you just did parks and recreation, which is where we wanted to start, it was gonna be approximately about 40 hours and run anywhere between $6,000 and $10,000, $10,000 being the max to cut off.
Okay, just so you know, presumably this is going to come around again. I suggest that we, again, forward it for Board of Selectmen action, because until they do something, we can't do anything. We can strongly encourage them to take some kind of action. Can go to their meeting and strongly encourage them to take some kind of action. I did that once, didn't I? I'm the same thing. Then the next thing, Ben has brought to our attention the need for a separate legal defense budget that is beyond the retainer and the scope of that. Okay. Now, that's this one. There was also yet another one, which was for
town meeting question.
For the town meeting question, where he says it's a conflict of interest for him to pursue that question because he represents the town and the first selectman. That's something else that, are you pursuing that? Are they pursuing? Another thing they haven't had?
Well, this is interesting, again, this whole process.
We will be out of here by 9, I promise.
Yes, this week, I will keep.
Well, oh, wait a minute.
I'm gonna try, use complete text.
I like it, I like it.
So, first of all, you know, we're early in the budget process, but this was an event that happened, I believe, in the mountains of Seattle on July 4th. It was immediately after the start of the fiscal year. It was an unforeseen event, as most legal events are. But you budget, this was something that was just generally totally unforeseen. And just so you know what it has created as a matter of legal work, there is an unemployment claim by Mr. Mitrangelo that's been filed. There's a subpoena served on the town by the Office of Child Advocacy. There's interactions with the Connecticut State Police. There have been no less than 11 FOIA requests and no less than 5 FOIA appeals. Those were filed by the registered reporter who's been comes to meetings. So that's just legal work that has arisen since about the first week of July. You know, definitely something that we could not have forecasted as part of the budget process. So I said, you know, thinking about Bethany, thinking about the 169 towns. Now, I've been practicing in municipal law for 30 years. I represent 13 towns. I represent the town of Greenwich, town of Bethany. The same issues you're wrestling with, even though you say Greenwich, Bethany. In other words, you're all throwing away garbage, repaving roads. You know, the issues from a legal perspective, what it takes from a lawyer to put in. You know, I'm still charging the same thing, right? Because I'm reviewing the contract. If there's an affordable housing application that's filed in this town, or if it's filed in another town, it costs the same to defend. So Bethany's size as a community doesn't affect that legal expense, is the point. Mm-hmm. When you're presented with an event like this, you just don't know what legal issue is going to arise at. And so I thought it was important to bring this to you early in the process. You know, I mean, there's money in your legal line item today that, you know, stuff, but so you can think about this. You don't have to take action today. But I want you to be aware of it. You have a lot of legal issues to address. I'll also let you know that I just discovered the retainer between the firm and the town That the we bill the retainer, but we get paid $3,100, and most of what we do on a day-to-day basis is billed to the retainer. So no matter what we do, on average, I bill $8,000 a month, and I lower it down to $3,100. If it's outside the retainer, according to the retainer, I'm supposed to be billing $250 an hour. I'm only billing $200 an hour. Oops, that's on me. So I just discovered that.
You don't have to discover that.
No, you know, I'm gonna keep that $200. But just so you're aware, on the strange low, just kind of the, what's arisen, the bill for July is $7,100. Now I'm gonna review that. I may reduce it. But that's kind of where we stand. Just. Not on the FOIA stuff, not on the unemployment stuff, not on the subpoena. That's just on the going to these town meetings, going to this board of selectmen. I mean, there have been special board of selectmen meetings, special board of finance meetings, special town meetings stuff that lasts forever. You know, we never get out of executive session, you know? And then we get up in the morning and there's 50 questions. So legal has been just, Bethany is not a quiet town like it was in June. Right, so I can't predict. No board can predict, and so I'm always accepting of the criticism because it comes from people who don't understand, and I get that. Because why would anyone? You can't predict, and no lawyer can predict. I don't care how good that lawyer is, what it's going to take until it happens, and I didn't create it. I found out, I'm going to be as honest as I can be, and the first level woman knows this, she and I had some words, because I found out too late in the process. But that didn't, when I reflect back, it wouldn't have changed anything. You know, people can be angry, people can be upset, but there were events that happened, there were facts that happened, but the reality is, the actions taken by the town had to balance the interests of protecting the children, the interests of the employee, the liability to the town, because we didn't know, I didn't know anything, but the first level we didn't know whether any of the allegations, and there was no way to know. And we can't impute on then the facts that we know today. That's not, we just can't do it. So based on what, if I were giving advice then, based on what I know today, the outcome would have been no different. Because you can't risk impairing the reputation of a young gentleman based on uncorroborated, unknown claims. You know, that would be exposing the town to unknown liability. So what do? You take the person out of the environment immediately. That was immediately. All right, he was put into a closet to work. Second question. But he was not around children, and as soon as the children came back in, he was let go. So, you know, again, criticism, I don't get involved in that. As a matter of what I would have given as a matter of legal advice, I don't think my legal advice, if I gave it then, would have changed anything. So if I'm looking at this fairly and partially, honestly, and again, trying to listen to everyone, and I've spoken to members of the public out in the park lot, and once we have an intellectually honest conversation, and this is not a time for us to kind of throw spears at each other, there's a lot of liability coming to this town if we don't play our cards right. And before we start throwing people further under the bus, let's just remember the facts. What do we know? What did we do? What were our concerns? We did everything right. We did everything right. And nothing could have been done differently. Notices of liability. It is our job as elected bodies to protect the liability of the town based upon the best information we have. And everyone can criticize us. But they don't know everything that we know. So there's going to be a lot coming, and I need to be back. I'm going to keep you as informed as I can. Okay? But
what do we do here?
Well, so what I'm going to ask.
That's really.
So, this is the problem. I'm gonna ask the first, what, well, your next regular meeting?
Is, well, I can have a special one. Is September, the day after Labor Day, so that's the third.
So I want to be sensitive to the town meeting's question. I don't want to delay too much on getting them their answer. For that, I'm gonna request an appropriation of $7,500. It's gonna range probably between $5,000 to $7,500. That sounds fair to find a lawyer to put a memo together to answer a relatively straightforward question. All right, then at $200 an hour, which I'll try to get you to do, that should be plenty of. With respect to, what I'm gonna say, the Mestrangelo line item, I don't know if we need action of the Board of Selectmen first. I don't know, I honestly don't know what to tell you for way of appropriating, except the month of July, I can, based on my time entries, we have about $7,200. That's not gonna carry forward every month consistently. Some months gonna be zero, some months gonna be 10,000, some months gonna be 2,000. So, you know, if you wanna, for the sake of a number, 7 times 10 is 70, right?
No, 70 times 10 is 700.
God, that sounds so expensive. That's why I don't know how aggressive the new remuneration report is gonna be. I'm getting FOIA requests every day, and as soon as I don't respond, I get FOIA complaint filed with FOIC. So, which isn't separate, that's under, so it's not very nice, you know. So, and we're trying to do everything that we can do to be responsive. And we're also trying to take a step back and look at the government as a whole as to what needs to be done. So my recommendation now would be to consider $75,000. And I will, what I would suggest is when I submit my monthly invoices related to any Mestrangelo matter, that they be copied to this body, so that this body be aware of the legal expense, since it's a special expense. And we can just talk about it as we're going forward.
All right, back here, just one thing. 7,500 times 10 is 75,000, not 700.
But he said 70. That's what he said.
Well, that's my Italian math going.
Yeah.
All
right, so what I need to do then, I guess, is go to the Board of Selectmen and ask them to request, I don't really know how this ought to work. First, a $7,500 for the special counsel for the singular question that you're not called, you have to disqualify yourself for. And that's a conflict of interest. And ask for, or tell them it's been recommended that we set up a $75,000 line for special legal expenses. Now I've got a question about a third one.
But that special line, isn't that specifically for Mestrangelo?
It would be for legal related to Mestrangelo. Yeah.
Okay. But do we also need to be looking now at potential funding for damages?
I'd like to reserve on that because yeah. I think. So let me say something broad.
Quickly.
Intentional acts are generally not coverable. Right? You hit someone with a 2x4, insurance isn't covered. So I'm not prepared to answer the question. You may not have coverage. Right? And so, but we're not gonna lose sleep over this. You don't get word until I get word, right? Because what we're going to do is we're going to discuss it with Kerma, and we're going to be certain first And if, yes, yes, and if there's an issue of concern, we're gonna have, because we have to remember, we have to disclose this on our financial reports. Okay, so this is something that, this is why I say, we have to start acting more responsibly as citizens, because this is something that affects this town globally. It can affect your real estate property tax, values, you know, because there's five potential or more victims here with potential large claims, right? I don't know what the jury might do one day. So let's just settle down and come together and move forward.
At what point do you think you could make a recommendation to us?
My plan is to have to meet with Kermit in the month of August.
So wouldn't it make more sense for him to present it to the Board of Selectmen so the Board of Selectmen reported to us by September 10th? Because they're meeting ahead of us? Because if we get it September 10th, then we have to forward it to them. They're not going to meet again until October.
Look.
And we're just pushing it down the road.
I would like to point out to you that at several Board of Selectmen meetings, I have requested that they take action on certain things, and that's not happening. But yes, we can. I don't know.
And I've discussed this with both selecting, all three selecting, independently on the phone.
We need for this to happen. Okay.
Well, Sharon, just for purposes of your plan, and again, I don't want to get ahead of ourselves. I don't want anyone to get concerned. I don't want to see headlines tomorrow, right? We definitely need this to be part of your budgeting going forward.
Yeah.
Right. But,
yeah, but we already have a budget for fiscal 25.
Right, but we don't necessarily have any claims made.
Oh, no.
Right? We have potential. So we don't have, we may not have a this fiscal year concern. So that's what I'm saying. I don't want to get ahead of ourselves, but I want us to be aware.
Okay. All right. Then I will go to their meeting. Well, here's the thing. Do we need for them to request for us to meet? Well, the $75,000 request requires a special town meeting.
Correct.
So I will go to them at their September meeting, or if there's a special meeting earlier, go and ask for a special town meeting.
This is my thought, Sharon. The answering the question of the special town meeting doesn't require action on the special town meeting because it's $75,000. I don't want to go to that special town meeting without having the answer, giving them their answer, right? So let's keep that in mind also. So selectmen are gonna authorize me to retain independent counsel and request this body to appropriate.
Okay.
And then
they didn't do that at the last meeting.
No, so we're gonna do that at this meeting.
That promise.
Well, I'll be there.
I mean, it's getting very difficult because
was the independent investigator hired?
No.
No, it'll be this Thursday. Which
person are you talking about?
That was supposed to be the 31st. Was supposed to be a conversation about that, and I don't think that happened. I was not here because I've accused myself from that process, but nothing happened at that meeting.
Yeah.
So we don't have to worry about
That was already approved for that. Well, huh? Wasn't there $75,000 already approved? Yeah, but Sally is saying that there are several independent counsel, independent counsel is separate from the special counsel because of his 500. Which is the $75,000. And this other $75,000 is for additional legal expenses.
Yeah, no, I know, I'm gonna be better, I think she was okay, yeah, cause.
I knew it.
The town meeting referred to but the other owner is consultant.
Yeah, no, I know, I'm following all that, but I think she just, that being her question pretty much.
So we didn't get to do it.
That's very complicated process.
Not really, though.
I will go to their meeting and plead for action.
Oh, you're saying.
We'll be there too.
Yes, I will.
Yes.
Is that Thursday?
I'm sorry?
There's a meeting on Thursday?
They, that's their special meeting, well, that was one of my things, I had to come under my thing.
Oh, okay. All right, it's your turn.
Okay, we're waiting on Russell Road, we're waiting on solar, we're waiting on Simpson. That seems to be the pattern, but hopefully before I die, that will all come to closure. I'll go some direction now, probably sooner than later. Special Board of Selectmen meeting on Thursday with just Bob and Gina, that's at 7:30, that will be in the commission room. That is for them to discuss the scope of work and how they're going to advertise and retain the independent counsel.
The investigator.
Investigator person, yeah, to do the review of that. So, so yeah, so that, what you were referring to. Hopefully we'll get something accomplished on Thursday when they meet again, so.
And is that hybrid?
That is hybrid, it will be, they will have public comment, which will pertain only to the item of the scope of work. People can only comment on their input of scope of work and the advertising of the, you know, how they're gonna do it.
Okay.
To retain that person, so that it does not go on to any other diatribes and ransom rates, it'll be totally focused.
Okay.
So, and that's pretty much, I hope, pretty short as possible.
Okay. Okay, the next, the control and sustainability issues, we've been asking for several years now for some of this stuff to happen. Some of our organizational controls to be analysis and whatever to be put in place, and it's kind of very, very much an important question right now. And the lack of organizational depth is huge, because so many of the questions that every townspeople have, people who work in the town hall, attorneys, reporters, that everybody has, they all go through Jen's desk. Right?
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
I'm not lying. And I mean, I just saw the list of stuff that they want. Who's going to do all this stuff? We have nobody to.
It was just a suggestion.
But, Jen. Anyway, if we can ever figure out the scope of things related to, I'm not sure which investigation or analysis, he has some interns potential. But, okay. You two want to hit these?
Are we talking about the lack of organizational depth, or are we going on to HR analysis?
Well, it doesn't.
I can tell you that they all go together.
See, I see there's one great big small ball, yeah.
It is. So here's the thing. So Board of Finance, I think there's a different conversation for the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah.
But for Board of Finance, here's some of the things. So first of all, I know that the consultant was turned down, or tabled, postponed, whatever you want to call it at this point. But I will say I will continue to advocate for that. I think that it is very, very difficult for somebody who is internal to be able to do an unbiased assessment of what's happening in the town. I think when you're immersed in a situation, it's very difficult to look at what should be instead of what has been. And so I will continue to advocate for that, because I think that, you know, there are comments that it should happen, and that's what we're paying for people in the town and all the things, and I'm not disagreeing. But I think in this situation that there needs to be an outside perspective. And I can't do that. Paula can't do that. Leslie can't do that. We've been here long enough where we've seen what has been, and we need to have it from a biased perspective.
Just a quick thing, Bethany. No, in
2 minutes or less.
In my Michelangelo review, I've looked at personnel files, and there were things done. So this is going back a couple, in prior administrations, like 2012, getting W-4 forms for employees that were hired before that. So we're going back administrations. I mean, W-4 forms for new hires, that we don't have. So it's like, these are basic things that, that it's like I question why. Why didn't we have that? And, so that was in someone's personnel form from 2012. So it's not a today issue. It's a always been issue. And now we have to fix it. So that going forward, we don't have to address it. So that's what I'm saying. It's time to just get done.
So from that piece, I think, obviously, it starts with Parks and Rec, because that's where the crisis is, or I don't know, chaos, whatever you want to call it. We need to handle that situation first. And then I really do think that it needs to be the entire town hall and how it functions, and I think that you're going to see some interesting results. My next thing is, I would say for the Board of Finance, is that we need to build our communication. I have been advocating for push technology for 2 years. I think that most people do not go to a website anymore. They do not, take any extra steps. If you have to do 14 clicks in order to get to your agenda, it's not going to happen. Whereas push technology has kind of been at the forefront of allowing people to pick up their phone, it's right there, get the text, that you want. If you want to unsubscribe, have at it. But it's something that you offer to the town, gives them updates in various locations, right, and what's happening. I think there needs to be more social media presence. I think that, most of the things I see on Facebook, though lately we have been a little better, I think most of it shows up is our human services senior lunch. And what's happening down in the senior center. But we're not really pushing anything that's happening, what we're doing, and really good things that we do internally. What does that mean? Besides, obviously, having some more, funding for technology, I think that we need an IT person. We need a minimum of part-time IT person. Social media, yes, of course, but there needs to be somebody who can stay on top of communication on a consistent basis, and I cannot do that with the amount of workload that I have. So. I would think that should be a conversation at some point. I did, obviously, stepping back, I looked at the push technology, and it's $4,000 a year and covers every possible text message that you could possibly want to send in any kind of location, including DPW, for any emergency needs or road closures or any kind of thing like that. So I just wanted to throw out a number in case you're wondering how much that would cost a year. The next thing is that we probably as a town should be looking into wellness things for our town. I just added on for the for staff, but families, community, things like that. We don't offer anything. We don't have a social worker in town. We don't have anything. So we outsource. We do have a consortium with Woodbridge, but it appears that there really is no value there for us on a majority of these issues because they gear towards Woodbridge, Milford, Orange, that category. We're not falling in that category. So maybe that needs to be a relook on what we're actually offering for our town. The EAP, the Employee Assistance Program, costs us now, I just signed up, $3,500 a year. And that covers them for any kind of counseling they may need, includes rape counseling, includes mental health, just in general, it includes lawyer advice, legal advice. There's a whole gamut. They also do some training for like slight additional costs. They can come in and do entire town trainings. There's other things they can do there. I think there's a big value there to continue past this year. I will continue to look to see what that value is. Right now, I looked at it from a mental health / legal advice piece so that they had something, but I think that there's more value there as I look into it. I also want to advocate for some sort of expense line in like an HR department because we need money to be able to train and educate people. I can't keep finding free stuff. Right now we're doing everything through Kerma because it's a free plan, but I don't think that necessarily it's most user-friendly. I don't think it's necessarily getting the exact information that we need to get as a municipality. So I would like to be able to look into that, but it's gonna cost money. That also includes some of the OSHA compliance and things like that. And then I would also advocate, obviously for myself, but continuing education from an HR perspective. I went and I got my own HR degree or PHR. It didn't cost the town anything but a book and sort of pay for this, the test. I did everything else on my own. But I think that going forward, there is more advanced classes that allow for more labor law type things. I'm not a labor law lawyer. I'm not ever going to be. But some of these things with FOIA requests and just you know, workers' comp and unemployment and things around there that we do have it. It's not something that we haven't had. It just hasn't come to light like it has recently. And I think there needs to be more education in particular around that arena for now, but also looking at how to maintain internal personnel. And that's what I have for now.
Thank you. What else? Do we have any other business? Oh, I do want to point out, by the way, that our new auditors have already remarked on the lack of organizational depth. Yes, thank you. No, no, you have whatever.
Not surprised.
No.
Been in our management letter for how many years?
I know. Okay. Any other business to come before us tonight? You're still sitting here.
She got money. She had to. She had to.
Bailout.
Wait. Your next. It's not a big deal, but the next meeting is September 10th, 2024. Okay, all in favor? Consensus, right?